consistency, knowing what students should know and be able to do, and then having that consistency with the retention. What is criteria for retention? I think that's been helpful for everybody. Overwhelmingly, they think the parent communication has been key to this whole process, is that they're communicating with parents before school starts, they're communicating with them throughout the year, and also at the end of the year. Reduced retentions is another one. And then the process that we use to revisit and revise every year has worked well, because we get everybody's voice in the process. And this year it's been great to be able to have that collaboration time so the teachers can talk about it throughout the year. Okay, so challenges in the future. Like I said, the first kindergarten group that we worked with, when we look back at that committee, there's maybe only one or two people on that committee or still in those grade levels that can give us that input. We don't have a lot of longevity with some of those people because we just don't have the people in those positions. The second one is creating valid, reliable measures. What we've tried to do throughout this process are use assessments that we're already using that we can gather information from instead of having to create our own. In some cases, we have had to create some that you do kind of worry about the validity and reliability of the measure. And then some changes that may occur down the road as a result of our new Illuminate system and our kindergarten readiness. And I'll let Monica and Krista talk to you about that.
So this year we have been using Illuminate, and it's basically, there's two sides of it, but there's like a data warehouse side where all the assessments and different things we do on students all come together, all of the data we collect come together, and then there is an assessment side where we can create item bank assessments. So third grade met, and we've discussed using what we're already doing within Illuminate as a part of their standards-based grade card. So right now they have a grade card assessment, so an additional assessment they take, and there's one per every standard that's on that grade card. So for math, they do customized assessments or common assessments, so they're already collecting all of that data within Illuminate. All of the questions have been aligned to standards and have gone through a revision process. So they're putting all of this into Illuminate already, and so when we're looking and pulling all of this out, some of the feedback we're getting is, why are we not using this piece? This is something we're already doing. It's a wider scope of how our kids are doing. So third grade is going to start next year. We're going to use this, and then fourth grade is meeting next week, so that might be an option for them as well. I get some of the same feedback from fourth grade about their assessments, so I'm assuming they'll want to jump on board, but we meet next week with them. But basically, this is just, I just kind of wanted to give you a visualization of what that would look like. This is a teacher report. At the top of each column is the standard. Obviously, on the left side would be the kid's names, but each standard is going to level the kid based on everything they've done for that standard. This particular thing just includes the assessment pieces. So if I was to do something formative just to see what the kids know, I wouldn't throw that in there. I'm wanting data I'm collecting after I've instructed them. So, for example, they've had 42 possible points or chances on this standard, and this is an overall view of that. This one's got 42, I know they're kind of hard to read, but 12, 28, 16, I believe. So basically, instead of one assessment where there's five or six questions, this is going to give me a more well-rounded picture of what the kids are doing. Another pro is it's something we're already doing, so it's not in addition to. I'm not giving an additional grade card assessment. This is what we're working with every day, the data we're looking at in PLCs. So it's just a more thorough picture of students. The next report, so I think by doing this and collecting all this data, it's going to be easier to communicate to parents how their students are doing on these specific standards. So again, this is generated through Illuminate, all this data I'm already putting in there, and it'll show, this is a student report, so this is based on one kid, the three standards, and I just picked a random three standards, and so it's a data point for each time that standard was assessed. At the bottom, it'll say what they were tested on and then how they did. So I can see these two standards, I started off at a level two, and then the three other times it's been tested, I've moved up to a 4.4 and a 3. So again, it's easier to see the progress of students from each standard. And this piece, one of the pieces with standards-based grading is it's so much tracking. You can't just give an overall, you know, 90% on an assessment. You have to know what pieces of that was the standard, what pieces of that was the standard. And this does all of that for the teachers because we've programmed it in and already set that part up. So something we're already using in the class, something we're already dumping into Illuminate, and then hopefully we'll give our teachers a roll around and picture of our students and standards and then help them communicate better to parents.
So when you say assessment, is that additional testing or is that just testing? Do you just mean testing throughout the school year on different standards?
You mean on these points?
Just in general. You use the word assessment. So I'm just, when I hear assessment, I think like state testing or something major, but so are you talking about just
all things are you're doing in class already. So there's different types of assessment. The state assessment would be more like a summative final, here's the score and this is it, I can't do anything with it. These are more like formative, so I'm using this data to drive my instruction the next day, or more interim, again, it's driving my instruction. So basically anytime you're collecting data or trying to figure out where your kids are, you're assessing what they know. So it's not a formalized norm reference high stakes assessment by any means. These are all the assessments within the curriculum, so pieces we were already giving anyway. Not in addition to. I call everything an assessment if you're taking the data and using it. So not like state assessments, and not in addition to something we're already doing and using. For these?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So when they're done, I grade the assessment, and then each one is tied to a standard. So I'll go in. There's different ways to get it into Illuminate. I can either hand key it, or there's like a Scantron or bubble sheet is another way the kids can bubble in, and then it's called a lightning grader. It grades like 100 pages a minute, and it'll dump it in there. So there's different ways to get it into Illuminate, but they do have to get it in there. They take it on paper, it's not online.
And you have these teachers using Illuminate, which grades?
Illuminate we're using for everybody, so pre-K-12. These pieces are all collected from our like common assessments, so those are K-8, the Eureka curriculum.
Okay, and another thing that may cause some of this to change is our kindergarten readiness program. And you met Monica before. She's been up here with Josh and Andrea. She's been part of the state group that has been working on this. So Monica, I'll let you share that.
Yeah, for kindergarten readiness and our readiness program, getting kids ready, especially here for kindergarten, we know the importance of early childhood and those experiences. And how important they are for school success. So we want to make sure we keep that in the forefront and have that has a direct influence on their future success. This year we've done lots of professional development with our preschool and our kindergarten teachers together. They've collaborated a lot this year, and we worked on child development, the learning environment, curriculum and instruction, some assessments, transitions and program structure, and we feel like we're just getting that started this year, so we will definitely be doing lots of professional development as we look forward at what's appropriate for kindergarten and preschool kids. We want to make sure their instruction is developmentally appropriate and at the same time keep it rigorous, because we know our standards for kindergarten are not changing, so we need to balance the developmental part along with keeping it rigorous, so that we can support our kids early as they're preparing for kindergarten.
There was a lot of discussion about whether or not we should have kindergarten screening this year, kindergarten and all that, because of the ASQ test being given a little bit later, and we may need to do something there. But I think this has just become the culture of what we do with the kindergarten roundup piece. Just the parent communication and the fact that every school, they like to give different resources to parents to let them work with their kids over the summer, and they just didn't want to give that up this year. So down the road, we may choose not to do the kindergarten roundup, but it'll all kind of depend on what happens with kindergarten readiness. So.
You had mentioned earlier, Ian, about not having
source of data.
Right.
So that probably helped us. In our work with early childhood, are we expanding the days in which some of these kids are attending our early childhood center? Is there something in the works there, or are we making greater investment in this?
Steve, I don't know if you can answer that one or not.
Yeah, well, one of the things we're looking at with our early childhood program is changing our model for how we're going to do the Friday screens. So we will be adding some time, probably for next year. I think we may be limiting their day from 3 hours to 3 hours and 5 minutes a day for next year, which anything we can do to increase the early childhood experiences is so there will probably in the total amount of time that kids actually get to attend the early childhood center, there will be somewhat of an increase for next year. I wouldn't say it's huge, but at least we are going the right direction.
We've also talked about how we can get more kids involved in early childhood services. We're going to talk in a little bit about a reading grant that we've written, and we would like to look at maybe adding a section for Spanish-speaking students that we transition into Buffalo Jones. So, you know, getting more kids with more experiences early on is important.
I have a question about the social and emotional kind of readiness. Is that tracked in any way, or tested, or screened, and monitored? Because I feel like that is a huge part of readiness for any grade level, really, not just the really young kids. Is there a way to screen?
Currently do not, but Crystal, what do you want to talk about?
We have a couple schools piloting like a social emotional screener. So it's a survey teachers fill out asking them different questions about students, and they rate them, and then you get results on like intrinsic versus extrinsic behaviors. So we're just piloting a free one right now. It's called SRSSIE, I believe. But we are looking at updating our screening assessment for next year. Currently we use Ames Web. One of the possible possibilities, and it actually goes to curriculum council tomorrow, has a social emotional screener within it. And it is the same thing as a teacher survey, but it also includes a student survey, so you can look at intrinsic versus extrinsic of the teacher, and then as far what the student, how the student feels, their behaving, or the reasons why they do what they do. So that does have a progress monitoring piece as well. So kind of a tool we haven't really had or trying to find, and hopefully that'll help us start that process.
Is it a particular school piloting it, or specific for like particular teachers? How many people are involved?
This year is several schools.
So they've reported, you know, with kindergarten readiness that they will be doing the ASQ, but they won't be doing that until the fall, correct? And so knowing that they're going to have to do that also, and that includes a lot of work with parents, should we be doing anything in the spring prior to that? Right now the feeling is yes, but as they get more into giving their NSQ, they may realize that the screening in the spring maybe doesn't have a lot of benefits. So.
Thank you. Can you back up any slides to your challenges? Mm-hmm. So I understand the third bullet.
Okay, changes that may occur as a result of illuminating kindergarten readiness. For instance, right now with some of the assessments, I've been working really hard to try to find a phonics assessment at the second grade level because we don't feel, the one we feel like we're using is not great. So we're trying to find something, and Illuminate may be able to help us with that because Illuminate also has assessments with it that are already created, they're already valid, they're reliable. Instead of us coming up with something that may not be quite that good, we may be able to use that tool for that. That's just an example.
So I think just in talking about parents, I think that they've struggled a little bit with the standards-based report card. Is that something
the teachers are very supportive of that? We're just kind of weighing everything right now. We're not moving on to the fifth grade level yet, but we do have teachers at the fifth grade level that have expressed a desire to go that direction. And I believe even some teachers from the middle school are looking into that as something that they would like to consider. So at this point, we're just refining what we already have, but I do know there is some interest in moving that forward.
What's been your overall feedback from especially at the third and fourth grade level?
I haven't really received any feedback this year from anybody. You guys heard anything?
I, as a parent, had a third and fourth grade the last 2 years, but I haven't heard anything directly from parents. My feedback's from teachers.
Can you help someone who's just been on the board for a little while to understand if you retain someone in a grade? How does that affect financing, the school financing formula for that student?
I don't know that I can address that.
You're considered a full-time student at the grade level that they are currently attending, so it doesn't negatively or positively affect funding, except that we could potentially have that one extra year. But we absolutely...
So we don't have a financial assistance center. Barriers are to retention of students through grades. One of the things I try to wrap my head around as a new school board member is how ready are the kids by the time that they finish high school. And I don't think that readiness is a reflection of just 12th grade. That readiness is a reflection of all of the grades that preceded 12th grade. And of course, anecdotally, stories of kids that are passed from grade to grade when they probably likely should have been retained. And so I'm trying to educate myself about what the factors are, what the incentives are for teachers to pass somebody through a grade that's really not ready to be passed through that grade. So the first question I ask is it financial? And the answer is no. Is it parent pushback? Is it, I just really would like not to have this kid in my class anymore?
I think that's where the exit criteria really has helped, because if there's a question, you take a look at that, and that gives you a pretty cut and dry answer as to whether they're ready or not.
That's what I like.
Yeah.
But as you move up, and I don't know what's your intent in terms of how far part of the grade.
I don't know that that's been determined.
It's very difficult.
We would like to move up to fifth grade.
Fifth grade.
And we know that there is interest there, but we've taken it kind of one year at a time so that we can develop it fully and to really study it, you know. But we are hearing, and it's anecdotal, but we are hearing from more than fifth grade teachers that they feel that their students are more ready for those grade levels than they have been in the past. So we are getting that feedback.
Actually, it was a question of mine too in looking at this, the multiple assessment page that you showed us. So how many of those red marks can they have? I mean, how would they look at this, a snapshot of this, and determine whether or not, you know, if they've met some but clearly haven't met others, and there's quite a discrepancy. So what would happen to a student?
On the third grade card, each of the, they're called focus standards, are listed, and then they would just, so for example, this kid would get a grade for this standard, a grade for each of these would be a separate grade. So there would be five different grades or marks.
Okay, so just like normal, it's an accumulation and then a final grade.
Yeah, so we on the grade card, we just have each, I guess, standard broken down. We don't have an overall. So like ELA, here's the five. We don't have an overall ELA grade. It's just the five different components or focus standards. Same thing for the math.
And it's accumulation over time.
With this, it will be. Currently, it's a grade card assessment. So that was some of the feedback we were getting. It's not yearly. It's not the progress my kids have done the whole year or collection of data. It's one point. And is that truly really showing what my kid can do throughout the year? So we're hoping this addresses that. So part of the reason of not rolling it up to fifth is some of those things were coming up and we didn't really see in K through two, but really starting some in third and then this year in fourth. And we're like, we need to really look at this and get this right before we are rolling it up. And then figuring out, because eventually they'll need those GPAs, so how do we, taking this and the five different components, how do we get an overall grade that can be converted into a percentage that can be converted into a GPA? So that, yeah. And that will play a role in it later on too.
Well, I really appreciate you doing that, like stopping, not just, you know, steamrolling it through to make sure that it's ready for the next stage, because I think that would be a little bit shocking or daunting.
Illuminate that we've used this year is a great, it's been a great tool, a great resource to help us break that all down. I mean, that's a lot of work to identify what standard is everything and break it all apart and find. So this tool's really helped that. It's taken the clerical work out of that and allows me really just to look at my data. That's helped a lot. Makes it a little more useful.
We don't know the capabilities of this tool. I mean, just using it this year, but Crystal has gone above and beyond. Spent many hours learning about it, and I think you've gotten kudos from the company for being kind of a fast learner, so.
It's not perfect, but it's a really good tool, so it's got some really cool things playing with it.
Sorry to violate the tangent from the car.
No.
Okay.
I'm curious as to what the learning curve is for teachers using this. Illuminate, it sounds like it's relatively new.
We've been using it for about a year. So we did have the beginning of the year just learning all the different pieces, learning how to put this data in an efficient way. But that was, I think, October, we started putting our assessment, our common assessment data in there. I think the first couple weeks we had, you know, some extra trainings and some frustrations or struggles with it. But as far as feedback from the field, that hasn't been coming. I think that once they got the data in there and they're able to see what they can get out of it, it kind of, it helped make that worth it. And they saw the purpose in it. It was useful. It was beneficial of their time. It really helps you figure out what the kid is missing. So let's say you know, I'm getting these test backs and I just think, oh my gosh, you know, this kid's bombing my math class. And when I dive down, it's really just this one little piece. So I can really focus what I'm doing and focus my differentiation, or maybe it's something that they need extra practice on. Because sometimes we get an overall grade and it's not reflective of overall. Maybe I've got 80% of it and it's just this little bitty piece I don't have. This helps, will help teachers break that down.
Good information. Thank you for preparing that and sharing the information for us. I'm sure it's really important to look at that and think about it.
Exciting. We would like to talk with you about a birth to grade 12 literacy plan that we are starting to create. But first of all, I would like to officially introduce you to Monica. Monica Diaz was a kindergarten teacher in our district for many years. In fact, well, she was also an interventionist for a couple of years, and then she was a literacy coach. She was one of the people on our first kindergarten committee, and she's changed positions. This year she came to central office to be our English as a second language coach, and next year she will be the English as a second language and English language arts coordinator, taking over my part of the reading job. So anyway, we have a 7-year cycle for textbook adoptions. This was our year to look at English language arts. We decided that we needed to really take a step back and look at what are best practices in reading, what's the research saying about reading that maybe we aren't updated on, so we decided to make this a 2-year process instead of one. So in the middle of having the literacy group researching all of these things, the State Department received recognition that they are going to receive a $27 million reading grant. They were calling it the Striving Readers Grant, now they're calling it LINCS, or LINK, Learning Network of Kansas. Which will be awarded to 8 districts. We will know June 1st, because we did apply for that, we will know June 1st if we are one of the 8 to receive $1 million a year for 3 years. So we're very excited and we want to share this with you. But in the middle of all of that, the grant said that we had to have a literacy plan. Well, we didn't have a literacy plan, so we started working on that, and what was really good about that was the committee work that was being done was we were able to put that information and that research into this literacy plan. The State Department also provided a needs assessment for us to use that was a very lined out process that we could use with our team that was also needed in this literacy plan. So Monica's going to kind of go through the process with you and kind of talk about the literacy plan that we have in place. So
this is a summary. The actual literacy plan I think you have access to is maybe up to 80 pages long. So it's very in-depth, and it's going to be a great document for us to move forward with as we look at literacy in our school district. We started off with reviewing 8 practices that our literacy team looked at. There are practices that we currently use, but we wanted to make sure the research still supported some of those practices. So we'll go over the 8. We wanted to make sure we had a strong core instruction, which we'll talk about later. We're going to adopt a new textbook. We have a textbook adoption in the works right now. And we want to make sure that core instruction in the classroom includes the 5 components of reading. Those 5 are phonics, phonemic awareness, fluency, vocabulary, and comprehension. We wanted to take a look at our intervention program and model, the English learners, and the strategies we use to support those children, their writing instruction, our independent reading, the 90-minute reading block, early childhood and kindergarten readiness, and some supportive programs that we have in our district, which is the Kansas Reading Roadmap and some other programs that support literacy in our district. So the first area is the core instruction. So we just want to make sure that this year we're taking our time reviewing different textbooks. We have a committee of two people from every building in our district is represented on this committee, and taking time to review a new ELA textbook. We will purchase it this year, but the next school year, which 2019-20, it will be implemented. So we still have, we're still a ways out, and we're really digging deep into the research and components of the literacy textbooks that are out there. And we want to make sure that they're aligned to standards and provide supports for our special ed students as well as our EL learners. Intervention, we follow the MTSS framework for intervention, and we do that with a great deal of fidelity, and we're recommending that we continue that framework. We do have five different schools that have the Kansas Reading Roadmap program funded through, that's an after-school program funded through that grant. In order to keep that, we must follow the MTSS framework. That's a mandatory qualifier for those schools. So for our English language learners, we've done lots of research and looked at all the strategies and frameworks that are available for English language learners, and have determined that combining these strategies, we've come up with a framework called VOICE that we'll use in our district. Called, the acronym is VOICE. The acronym stands for Vocabulary, Objective, Interaction, Comprehension, and Evaluation. So in order to meet the needs of all of our students, we need to make sure we have the right supports for those, and our teachers have the professional development to provide that. And we'll talk a little bit, the next two screens will show the VOICE framework that we are going to roll out to teachers. And if you notice, one of the top lines has an effect size, and we've been doing lots of research on Hattie, and he's a researcher that does research on the research that's out there, and he collects all the research and finds effect sizes for different strategies that we're using, and we went through the research and found the highest effect sizes and made sure that those met the needs of our ESL students. So that kind of encompasses how EL learners should be instructed. This is a little bit about Hattie's research. So anything above a 0.40 is the zone we want to be in, and all of those strategies met that zone. Anything below that might be just a typical year, or it might be just the students living and breathing in the classroom might just naturally grow that much. So we wanted to make sure we were above that point and hit the zone of the highest zones we could for instruction. Writing instruction, we think, or the research shows that we need 30 additional minutes for writing each day, in addition to the 90-minute reading block. In that writing instruction, we're encouraging a 5 to 15-minute mini lesson. That's the direct instruction of writing and grammar as well, because we know that that's something our students are struggling with. So we're going to make sure that teachers are well informed of what that mini lesson should look like, and then make sure that the rest of the writing time is, we're embedding the grammar and the writing instruction in that writing time.
Excuse me, I just want to make sure I have that right. So you're saying a 5 to 15 minute mini lesson, and that's in that 30 minutes of instruction?
Yes.
So it's 5 to 15 minutes, and then 10 to 15 minutes the student, and that's that separate 30 minute writing from the 90-minute.
Correct.
Just making sure. Thank you.
Independent reading, we really looked at what independent reading should look like, and there's lots of research supporting independent reading and the importance of it. So in the independent reading time, we want to encourage students to do wide reading, which is a variety of reading, to develop their background knowledge, which many students are lacking. So in order to build their background knowledge, if we can encourage and encourage the more reading in the classrooms, pleasure reading, for example, we can build their background and stamina and fluency. So the 90-minute reading block is for kindergarten through eighth grade. And that should be, we've been doing that for several years now, and the research still supports that we have a 90-minute uninterrupted reading block. So that means no kids should be leaving for interventions or any other kind of, there shouldn't be intercom interruptions during that reading block. There should be no recess during that reading block. It's an uninterrupted time where they're working on phonemic awareness, phonics, fluency, vocabulary, and comprehension. So when we look at early childhood and kindergarten readiness, again, we look at the vision of the kindergarten readiness from the State Board of Education. We want to make sure we provide hands-on materials, adequate, developmentally appropriate for our students. We've started this year with lots of professional development so that teachers are aware of why we're doing this and the purpose of it, and the impact that we can have on children by making sure our classrooms are developmentally appropriate, but again, still rigorous enough to meet the standards at the end of kindergarten. Some of the supportive programs that we have in our district are the Kansas Reading Roadmap, and that is an after-school program that supports struggling readers. We have five different schools in our district that elementary schools that have that program to support the struggling readers. Bob is the Books on the Bus, and that travels to high poverty areas 4 days a week in the summertime from June through July. And we've really want to support access to print. Kids that don't have access to print in the summertime, we're bringing it to them. They can get on Bob once a week, or as many times as they follow Bob, and get free books off the bus. And that correlates with the Ledge program too. So through the Links grant that we applied for, we had to complete a needs assessment. So through that needs assessment, we created a committee. There was over 50 individuals on that committee. We had parents, we had birth to age 5 educators, early childhood educators, elementary teachers, middle school teachers, high school teachers, building administrators, and district administrators. And we needed to analyze those results, and we came up with 4 different priority areas to target for our literacy plan. So those 4 priority areas are a standards-aligned curriculum, community and partnerships, standards-aligned instruction, and professional development. Those were the 4 target areas we got from that assessment. The first one is standards-aligned curriculum. So we're looking at a new ELA textbook adoption for the year 2019-20. So having a strong core was a need that we're addressing. This is an exciting one, community and partnership. We noticed that there was a need for us to be more supportive of literacy in our community. So we are looking at the ELA coordinator, and which will be me, and a district family liaison. If we get the grant, we might be able to fund a family liaison to help get more involved in the community, go to community meetings, help support literacy discussions within our community, and coordinate that awareness of literacy by providing more opportunities for access to print. Just a few ideas were like little lending libraries. I don't know if you've seen they're like little houses